Thank you. Welcome again to worship for Grace Lutheran Church on this fifth Sunday of Easter. We are glad that you could be with us, whether you are listening on KTOE Radio or watching on one of our various digital platforms. If you want to connect with Grace Lutheran Church to learn more about our mission or find ways to support us, you should check out our website at www.gracemankato.org. Or you could follow us on Facebook, Grace Mankato ELCA. Our worship continues with the confession and assurance of forgiveness. We confess our sins before God and one another. Risen Lord, we see the miracle of your resurrection, yet so often live as though we are still lost in our sins. We rely on our own will. We remain stuck in the past, and we refuse that which is too uncomfortable or unfamiliar. Forgive us and open our hearts again to your freedom. Amen. Praise God. Christ is arisen. We have a new life, and the old has fallen away. Rejoice that you are truly forgiven, and go out and proclaim the grace that is free to all. In Jesus' name, amen. Blessed be the God who makes us one. Let us unite as sisters and brothers gathered around one table, one altar. Let us renew our bonds of love forged for us by Christ our Lord. Blessed be the God who makes us one.
You love. never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. You have made it clear that you desire your church to be united. Break down the walls which separate us, and build us back up again as one body in Jesus Christ, through whom we pray. Amen. Our first reading for today comes from Acts, chapter 18, verses 1 through 4. After this, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth. There he found a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, who had recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla because Claudius had ordered all Jews to leave Rome. Paul went to see them, and because he was of the same trade, he stayed with them, and they worked together. By trade they were tent makers. Every Sabbath he would argue in the synagogue and would try to convince Jews and Greeks. The church in Corinth that Paul founded struggled because of divisions within their churches. Even the disciples struggled with the desire to outdo each other, wanting to be the best. It seems that this desire to be right is not a new problem, but then as now, Christ still had and has a message of hope for all who are willing to hear it.
Oh,
second reading for today comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 34 and 35. But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. Jesus sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." And our focus scripture today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 10 through 18. "Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, 'I belong to Paul,' or 'I belong to Apollos,' or 'I belong to Cephas,' or 'I belong to Christ.' Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the house of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Here ends our readings. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Hi, everybody. And happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. I want to wish a very special Mother's Day to my wife, Betsy, my mom, Chris, and my mother-in-law, Carol. Happy Mother's Day to you guys, and happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. And so, kids, it's Mother's Day, so be extra special to your mom this day. Always treat her nice, but today, really crank that up a notch. So this morning, I want to do something a little different. When I worked at camp, we used to do skits to get a message across. And with that, I had the help of other camp counselors and kids that we could put in the skits. Well, it's just me and my kids refuse to be in these videos, so I have to improvise. So I'm going to use more of me to help out with this skit. And so a skit that we used to do at camp is called the Hug Machine. And we'd make a machine out of different kids doing different things to eventually end up with a hug. Well, we're not gonna do that. I'm gonna make a smile machine. And I'm gonna use a few different me's to get it done. And each of me is gonna be wearing a different hat. So the first me is going to wear a Twins hat. The second me is going to wear a Minnesota State hat. And the third me is going to wear a winter bomber hat. The fourth me, a Boundary Waters canoe area hat. And then the fifth me will wear a Moondogs hat. And so each one of me is going to be wearing a hat. And eventually, I'm going to end up with a smile. So the Moondogs hat me will be smiling at the end. But each one before will make a different face. And the next one can't make their face until the face of the first one is made. You'll see what I mean. So we start with the Twins hat me will make this face. And then after making that face, the Minnesota State hat me can make this face. And then after that one, the bomber hat me can make this face. And then once that one is done, the Boundary Waters canoe area hat can make this face. And after all of those have made those faces in that order, the Moondogs hat can smile. So let's try that. Let's try it again. Here we've got the Twins hat. We've got the Minnesota State hat, the Bomber hat, the Boundary Waters hat, and finally a smile with the Moondogs hat. So let's say me with the Boundary Waters hat doesn't want the Bomber hat anymore there because, you know, it's a winter hat. It doesn't have a bill that can be, you know, shading in the sun. And they just don't like him anymore. And the Twins hat me, and the Moondogs hat me, and the Minnesota State hat me. All agree, they don't need the Bomber hat anymore. So they send Bomber hat me away. And so it's just the four of them. And so let's say it's time for another smile. We start with the Twins hat me. We then go to the Minnesota State hat me. But then we got a problem. There's no Bomber hat me. And without Bomber hat me, we can't have the Boundary Waters Canoe Area hat make a face, which means I can't make a smile. So what ends up happening is the whole chain is broken because everything's not there working together. So we bring Bomber hat me back. And we try it again. So we got Twins hat me. We got Minnesota State hat me. And there's Bomber hat me. And then Boundary Waters Canoe Area hat me. And finally, with the Moondogs hat, we got a smile. And so the whole point of this is that there are many different talents in the world. Many people wear different hats and have different skills. And we need all of them to work together in order to get something accomplished. Now, just because one person might be really good at building things and another person is really good at drawing things doesn't mean one's more important than the other. It means that they can work together and one can draw something and the other one can build that thing. And they've worked together to accomplish that. So you might be wearing different hats than someone else. You have different skills than someone else, but they're all very important. So have a great Mother's Day. Have a great week. And I'll see you again soon.
Here I am. All my intentions and all my obsessions, I want to lay them all down in your hands. Only your love is vital. Oh, I'm not entitled, still you call me your child. God, you don't need me. Somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life and where it should go. God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control. Give you control. I've had plans shattered and broken, things I had hoped in, they fall through my hands. You have plans to redeem and restore me. You're behind and before. God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life and the way it should go. Oh, God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control. So you want me. Somehow you want me. The King of Heaven wants me. So this world has lost its grip. Somehow you want me, oh how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life and the way it should go. Oh God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me, oh how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take up my hands and give you control. I give you control. I give you control. I want to give you control.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, in the midst of a world divided by the barriers that we ourselves have created, I bring you words of peace and hope. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the one who has joined himself to humanity in ways that can never be undone, and who unites the world into one body, through which the kingdom of God is revealed. Friends, I had the strangest thing happen to me this week. I was on Facebook, and as you know, it's full of people's opinions. And I have a little bit more free time to just scroll through it. In between teaching kindergarten and waiting for the noodles to boil for our mac and cheese lunch. And I really try not to stick my nose out there too much, but sometimes I've got to admit, I take the bait. Someone will post an opinion that is completely different from what I might believe. Maybe it's so far off from what I would consider a soundly reasoned argument, and I have to ask the question, have you considered the possibility that maybe this isn't the only way? And I tell myself I'm being helpful. I tell myself that I am shining a light of truth. But I know the truth. Nothing I say on the internet is going to change someone's mind. I should just walk away, or rather click myself away from the situation and move on with my life. As many of you may have experienced, this kind of thing often does not go so well, no matter how kindly we word our suggestions. But this time something different happened. We ended up having a conversation. And at the end, neither one of us had changed our minds, but we agreed to disagree. He told me to have a nice day. Who does that? But to make things more confusing, the same thing happened the week before when I stuck my nose out there. I'm part of this group that shares dad jokes with each other, and I love it. It's silly, they're terrible jokes, but it's fun. And somebody posted something that just wasn't a joke. And so I suggested that perhaps what he had posted was more of a hurtful stereotype than it was a joke. And I had fully expected at that point to be called a delicate snowflake or to be told where I could go with my suggestions, but to my shock, I was actually surprised. He apologized. Not just to me, but to the whole group. He deleted the post, and then he sent me a private message, apologizing again. What just happened? First, we're stuck inside for weeks on end, and now people are being nice to me on the internet. In truth, of course, people are nice on the internet. We know that there are kind, wonderful people in the world, but for some reason, we just don't expect them to come out. In an avenue of society where we find that we have the ability to be just a little bit more anonymous than in everyday life, it's easier to care less, to be a little bit more direct with people when we don't expect we're ever going to meet them face to face. And so our default can be to expect the worst of others. But why is that our default? Why is that my default? I don't want to be that person, and yet here I am. We live in a world where we now have shorthand terms specifically designed to write others off. We have these names that we use to classify somebody as something other than myself, as less than, and therefore not even worthy of my consideration, not worthy of my time. I don't need to listen to them. There are the snowflakes, too soft and delicate to handle the truth that we offer. Or you might say, okay, boomer, and write someone off as too close-minded to ever change. There are the angry Karens of the world, exacting their revenge on an unsuspecting manager, or the hover parents who make every teacher's life miserable. All of these are arguably hurtful, and yet all of us have been these people as well at some point in our lives, or probably will be. What is it that drives us to create such shorthand? What is it about humans that drives us to allow even more hurtful stereotypes based on race, religion, gender, or sexual identity to persist in our hearts and our minds, to write someone off as different, as less than, to expect less from others simply because they are not us, or because they do not agree with us? And I'm not saying that we just allow people to do whatever they want and promote hurtful ideas, but I am saying that we are not morally superior to others by default. It is not by nature our right to be right. Is it our own pride? Is it our insecurities stirring us deep within, telling us that we're not enough? Do we tell ourselves that everything's going to be okay as long as I'm just a little bit better than someone else, anyone else? Do we build these imaginary divisions between ourselves and our neighbors for a reason? Do we create them to make us feel better, smarter, to protect us? What are we so afraid of? The truth is that each time we draw a line that divides us from anyone else, Jesus is on the other side of that line too, not necessarily agreeing with them or with me, but Jesus is on that other side loving them, standing there with them, and loving them. And by writing someone off for being the person that all of us have been at some point in our lives, we're never going to make the world a better place. The kingdom of God is not illuminated in the ways that we're able to reduce others to a simple label in our minds, something other than ourselves, something other than our sisters and brothers, beloved children of God. We don't have to live in a world like that, divided between us and them, me or you. You don't have to live in a world that belongs to either Donald Trump or Joe Biden. We don't have to live in a world that is either liberal or conservative. It doesn't have to be that way. Because in Jesus Christ, we are invited into a kingdom that is all His. There is only us, all of us. We only win this game when all of us win. Jesus is not divided half on my side, half on yours. Jesus stands in between, in the midst of and intertwining all of us with creation, calling us to Himself. We don't have to be cynical. We don't have to expect the worst. We are invited to a life lived in the light of the One who gave everything up in order to free us from all of that. We are free to let go of our right to be right, and instead we get to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our strength. We get to love our neighbor as ourselves. It's tempting to sit in that pool of self-righteousness or to be sucked into the negativity of a world that feels like it has gone off the rails. But it hasn't. The world is today as it has always being. It is an imperfect, broken world. But it is full of God's beloved children, and we also have the opportunity to love them. Forgiven and saved by the power of God through the cross of Jesus Christ, rather than by our own goodness, may we have the grace to forgive each other in spite of everything else. May you who are loved as you are have the peace in your hearts that comes from knowing and believing that you are enough. You are loved just as you are. And finally, may we live into that freedom that we have been given by loving others as we ourselves have longed to be loved. Thanks be to God. Together, as one church throughout history, let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now we pray for the church, the world, and for all those in need. Regardless of the background, opinion, theology, or ability we all belong to, O Lord, speak over our stubbornness and certainty that we are right. And show us instead what it looks like to practice a radical love which truly listens to and respects others. Your creation is a perfect model of the interdependence that we all share as your children. When we fail to acknowledge our fundamental connections, everyone and everything suffers as a consequence. Bring us back to ourselves, to each other, and to you. Bless all who celebrate Mother's Day, and give strength and guidance to all who parent or mentor the young. As you tend and care for us, so may we look after those who depend on us. Send the power and comfort of your healing spirit to all those whom we know need it, especially Pete, Bill, LaDonna, Randall, Lauren, Margaret, Renee, Dick, Vi, Robin, David, Andrew, and all those whom we name in our hearts now. Together with all of your saints in light, we join our voices in praise to the one who forgives, redeems, and joins us all in one eternal fellowship. May all these things be granted in the name of our Savior Jesus, who earnestly prayed that we might all be one. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And at this time, I invite you to take a moment to share the peace with those who are around you today, and also to reach out to someone whom you are unable to be with today. Send a quick text message, an email, or write them a letter. Let them know that you are thinking of them. Our worship today continues with the offering. Thank you again for the ways that you continue to support the mission and ministry of Grace Lutheran Church. To make a donation today, you can go to our website, gracemankato.org. We will also have some instructions on a slide coming up. There is a link right on our homepage where you will find instructions on how you could make a one-time donation or sign up for regular online giving as you feel called. Know that it is because of people just like you and your generosity that we are able to continue to serve this community, open our doors to other organizations, feed our neighbors, and reach out in so many other ways. Thank you for your continued support. Serving you is the greatest honor, O Lord. Receive these gifts as signs of our gratitude to be a part of your fellowship and fellow workers in your kingdom for the sake of the world which you love. In Jesus' name, amen. When we are forced to be apart, we see most clearly the gift that we have been given in each other. So too, the body of Christ is the gift of Jesus' presence on earth, living and working through the church and through all believers. And it is comforting to have reminders of that promised presence, especially as we are unable to gather together as the body of Christ at this time in this place. And so in the hopes that we might all remember Christ's promise to be with us in baptism, in the church, in the sacrament of Holy Communion, hear these words today and remember that Christ is with you always. Hear now how on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering, we pray as our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. There is one body in Christ. Bring us together now to witness to your uniting love and immeasurable grace. Let us join our brothers and sisters, the saints of every age, as we live and work to let your kingdom be known here. Bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.